Connie will read.
The reading this morning from 2 Corinthians 5, 11 to 21. The Ministry of Reconciliation. Since then we know that it is to fear the Lord, we try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it is also plain to your conscience. We are not trying to commend ourselves to you again, but are giving you an opportunity to take pride in us, so that you can answer those who take pride in what is seen rather than what is in the heart. If we are out of our mind, as some say, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For Christ's love compels us because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So, from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Really warm welcome to all of you this morning, especially those who were dragged to church today. It's fine. Ever gets you here. This is a series. This is week four of the series. The series is called All in the Family. There is some printed material, although I don't know if there's any of that left, but there was some printed material that we've been using in our small groups, but the material, weekly materials in the bulletin, and you can get it there. And these sermons, but only audio, because we're not doing video at the moment, audio is on the YouTube page, so you can pick up there if you missed any. Or you think, gee, somebody has to hear this. My husband, my wife, my child, whoever, you know, you can point them to that. It's all there. Next week, I don't know if there's a good thing or a bad thing, but next week there's no sermon. But Sally and I will be sharing just some of the things we've learned, some of the mistakes we've made as parents, some of the parenting lessons we've learned. We're going to be sharing on some of those. We don't claim to know it all, but we're going to just share some of the things we've learned over this 34-year journey. Today we're going to talk about being reconciled to one another, especially in our families. And we're talking about family, over these 6 weeks, because the phrase mother, or the words mother, or father, or brother, or sister, or son, or daughter, or any of those things with in-law in them, are not emotionally neutral terms. They all have some emotion connected with them. They are emotionally laden. And one of the worst lies we can tell ourselves about the people in our families and the relationships around us, whether it be parent, sibling, child, whatever, one of the worst lies we can tell ourselves is, I just don't care anymore. I just don't care anymore. I've written that person off. This is perhaps the most harmful lie we can tell ourselves, or you can tell yourself, about your parents, your siblings, your children, but especially about our parents. And if you think you don't care, you're fooling yourself, because partly we were born, we were designed, we were created to be caring people. It's partly in who we are. And you can pretend that you don't care, but these relationships are so intimately wound that the more you try and pull away from the person, the more you try to convince yourself, I just don't care anymore, there's certain moments that just kind of pull you straight back. You kind of are pulled right back into the relationship. Because, and so whenever you have to do with that person, you are flooded with emotion, you become angry, you become frustrated, sometimes your own addictions kick back in, you play the blame game, or because at some point you try to convince yourself that you don't care anymore. Today, I want to talk particularly to Christ followers, to disciples of Christ, to people who would identify as Christian, who are struggling or thinking about continuing or reconciling a relationship with a family member of whom you might be tempted to say, I just don't care anymore. The relationship is now irreparably destroyed, and I'm washing my hands, I'm moving on. Friends, as followers of Christ, as disciples of Christ, we don't have a choice to cut people out of our lives because of what they've done or failed to do. Now, already you're having a debate with me in your head. And maybe sometimes you'll bring this debate to me. You'll tell me, yeah, it's easy for you to say, but you don't know how toxic that person is. You don't know how difficult they are. You don't know what they've done to me. And then you will start to tell me all the story. And I will agree with you. Man, that is really terrible. If I was you, I'd be tempted to say myself, I just don't care anymore. And it is really important in all that I'm saying here that we need to have healthy boundaries in our lives. We need to assess the type of relationship we might have with that family member, that toxic person, that person who's hurt us. We don't let them like back into our lives wholesale. Sometimes caring, sometimes loving members of our family means making tough decisions. It means cutting off an addict. It means not paying off a family member's debts anymore. That's love. That's caring sometimes. So caring isn't just saying, oh, well, it's all fine, and let's get back, you know, let's just get back into relationship. But in the midst of all of that, I want to stress that we don't have the choice, especially with the people in our, the family members in our lives, of saying, I just don't care anymore. As people who were made in the image of God, who were created by God, we are created to care, born to care. And even if you're not a Christian, that's true. And I want to say this to those of you who are Christians, or not Christians, or don't identify as that. In the midst of the tension, the drama, all the stress, all the fighting, whether you're a Christ follower or not, the relationships in your families are a losing battle that is worth fighting for. It's a losing battle that's worth fighting for. It's not something that we can just give up on, especially if we are Christians, and especially if you're a believer, follower of Christ. If you're not a Christian or don't identify a Christian, or you'd say, well, that's not really where I am, you actually have a choice. So you kind of look in from the outside today and say, okay, let's see what you Christians do. If you are a Christian, if you are a Christ follower, if you are a believer, then we actually don't have a choice. We have to do this. And it's not me saying that. It's Paul saying it. In 2 Corinthians 5, verse 14, he says this, for Christ's love, what is the word? Compels us. The old translation says constrains us. The reason we have to be open to reconcile to that person who has hurt you, disappointed you, you know, treated you badly, whatever they've done, the reason we have to be open to that is that we are compelled, we are constrained. The Greek word has the sense in it that we are limited. We have limited options because of Christ's love for us, because we are in a relationship with Christ. We are limited in the choices that we have. Our energy is somewhat focused. We can't just do what we want to do. Christ's love constrains us. For Christ's love compels us. Christ's love constrains us because we are convinced that one died for all, therefore all died. One died for all. What does that mean? Jesus died. Therefore, all died. Well, what does that mean? That sounds a little obscure. Paul says, okay, maybe that's not completely clear. So he elaborates a little bit in verse 15. He says, and he died, Jesus died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves. So if you no longer live, you are dead. Okay. So those, maybe you're not sure. If you no longer live, you are dead. Okay. Wasn't sure. Maybe you don't know how this works. So those who live should be dead, die to what? To themselves. Paul saying this, Christ did something for you. Christ did something for me. Christ did something for us. But let me make it personal. Christ did something for you that cost him his life. Christ did something for you that cost him his life. You need to do something for him that will cost you some of your life. That's the way it works. Christ did something for you that cost him his life. You need to do something for him that will cost you some of your life. You need to say no to yourself at points and yes to Christ. That's how this works. We need to, at some point, there will be a point where we have to say no to ourselves and yes to Christ. Again, you might argue with me, how, you don't know how terrible this family member is. You don't know how awful they were to me. You don't know all the things they've done to me. And I would probably agree with you and say, yes, that's awful. It's terrible. Horrible. But being a Christ follower, a disciple of Christ, means there are times when you have to say no to yourself and yes to Christ. That those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. They no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and was raised again. Let me ask you this question. When you say about a close relationship, and I'm talking about in our families, when you say about a family member, a parent, sibling, child, whatever, grandchild, whatever, when you say, I just don't care anymore about this relationship, about this person, I'm done with it, who are you saying that for? Is this for you or for Christ? Who is that for? Most times it's for you. Skip down to verse 18. All this, you're talking about being reconciled to God. All this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ. It's a big word, reconcile. But essentially it means to take two things that don't really fit together, two things that are out of sync with each other, and to bring them together so that they match. And I was thinking about how you would describe this, and I thought about Cecil Romberg. Now, Cecil Romberg is a locksmith, and Cecil, in his working life, which is sort of, he still works a bit, but when he was working every day, and now whenever he's doing his work, he is reconciling a key to a lock. Okay, so you've got a lock that doesn't work or whatever, you take it to Cecil, he takes a blank, and he cuts it, and he cuts it, and he cuts it, until that key is reconciled to that lock, and the lock opens. That's what it means to be reconciled. It's to take two things that don't fit together anymore, and to shape them so that they fit. So the next time you read in the Bible, reconcile, I want you to think of Cecil Romberg. Okay. We've sinned. In spite of the way we've got it wrong. In spite of the way that we've missed the mark so often. In spite of all of that, God offers us reconciliation. Reconciliation is in spite of and never because of. Never because of. God doesn't say to us, because you have shown your willingness to change, because you've done this, or been a good person, or kept the Ten Commandments, I'll let you into a relationship with me. It doesn't work that way. Reconciliation is in spite of, not because of. It is in spite of what we've done. It's in spite of how we've got it wrong. And it's not because of what we do. He has committed to us the message of reconciliation. He has committed to us the message of reconciliation. If you have faith in Christ, you have no option but to carry the message of reconciliation in everything you do. That should be our message. That should be the testimony of our lives. We, therefore, verse 20, we are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Paul saying, in case you're a little unclear about this, in case you're not certain about how this works, Let me lay it out for you. Let me be very, very clear. We are bearers of the message through our relationships, the way in which we treat others, the way in which we speak, the way in which we live our lives, the way in which we act and speak and think must tell others that reconciliation with God is possible no matter what your past. If we're not careful, though, we can reduce the gospel. And this is good news, by the way. This is good news. This is really good news. It's good news for us. It's good news for others. But we can reduce the gospel to this. We say to people, you can be reconciled to God in spite of what you've done. You can be reconciled to God in spite of what you've done. But you can't be reconciled to me because you've not done something that I want you to do, or because there's something that I think you should do. Can you see? That's often what Christians are guilty of, not so. You can be reconciled to God. All obstacles have been removed, but we can't be reconciled because there's something you need to do first. And so my standards, our standards, are higher than God's standards. God's removed every obstacle. We put obstacles in the way. We put hurdles in the way. To be reconciled to God, you don't need to do anything except accept God's invitation. But you can't be reconciled to me because you're not prepared to do what I want you to do, what I think you should do. Go halfway or whatever. If you're a follower of Jesus, you died to self. Jesus said no to himself and died on the cross and said yes to you so that you can say no to yourself and yes to him. That's how the transaction works. So you might say, all right then, smarty pants. Or maybe you say to Paul, maybe you want to argue with the Bible. That's fine. When can I give up on my abusive father? When can I give up on my emotionally distant mother? When can I give up on my deadbeat brother? When can I give up on my entitled sister? Well, you can give up on them. You know when? When God gives up on you. You can give up on them when God gives up on you. And you know when that is? Never. Never. Because you were created to care. And if you are in a relationship with Jesus and you're a Christian or Christ follower, Christ's love compels us. Now, I already know there are a whole host of objections that are coming. I'm going to talk just about three of them very quickly this morning. The first one is, there are complications. You don't understand how complicated this relationship is. And we need to work through a whole lot of things. Folks, reconciliation, opening the door, is not about working through the issues. It's not about condemning. It's not about coercing. It's not about getting your stuff out there. It's about setting the table, opening the door, sending the information. It's about saying to your father, he has a picture of your grandson. It's about sending someone a message saying, I hope you're doing well. Let's have coffee sometime or whatever. It's opening the door. So what are we going to do? Not deal with all that stuff. Just, you know, sweep it under the floor. Yes, it might need to be dealt with. Maybe those difficult conversations have to be had. Yes, maybe we have to confront some stuff. Yes, maybe the level of relationship has to be assessed. We're not going to whole scale let toxic people back into our lives. That's true. And you need to assess what kind of relationship you have with that person. But to say of them, I just don't care anymore, they're out of my life, I'm done with them, is not an option. Because why not? Because while you were still a sinner, Christ died for you. So it means you might have to send an email, send a WhatsApp, make a call, reach out. Yes, but if I, here's the second objection. Yes, but if I do this, I'm going to be condoning the relationship. I'm going to be condoning the relationship. You know, if I go there and hang out with my father who divorced my mother and married a woman 20 years younger than him, I'm going to be condoning the relationship. Yes, if I hang out with my gay sister and her partner, I'm going to be condoning the relationship. Yes, if I go and see my brother who's living with his girlfriend, I'm going to condone the relationship. If I go to my sister's wedding, who's getting married to a man who's been divorced twice, I'm going to be condoning that relationship. Well, firstly, if someone accuses you of hanging out with the wrong people, you're acting like Jesus. He was accused of that all the time. So well done. You're acting a bit more like Jesus. Secondly, this argument about condoning is actually something that we make up. It's actually something we use as an excuse not to do something. Most often. The reason we don't want to see that family member, the reason I don't want to be with my father divorced, my mother, I don't want to hang out with my gay sister and her partner, the reason I don't want to see my brother who's living with his girlfriend, the reason I don't want to go to my sister's wedding is I'm uncomfortable with that relationship. And I don't want to actually reconcile with a person, and so I cut them out of my life and say, I just don't care anymore. Not an option. While you were still sinning, Christ died for you. He didn't condone our sin, but he moved in spite of our sin. No matter what we have done, no matter what we do. The third objection is, no matter what I do, I've tried before, I've reached out, I've done this, we've been through this, we've done all of this, it's not going to work. Well, reality is, it's going to work. But maybe the person that's going to work on is you. Maybe the person who's going to work in is you. Whether or not it works to reconcile the relationship, your attempt to reconcile it can become the epicenter of God's work, new work in your life. You can look back at this time and say, gee, I grew more in that time in my life than ever before. It deepened my relationship with God in a way that I could never have anticipated. Yes, we weren't reconciled. I opened the door, I set the table, I sent out the invitation, but they didn't take the invitation. The reconciliation didn't happen. But reaching out to them became a transformative event in my life. Attempted reconciliation always works in someone. Maybe it will work in you. Maybe it's what you need to. Maybe there's some of you today have said or about to say, or maybe said a long time ago about a family member, I just don't care anymore. I'm done with this relationship. And today I want to challenge you, especially if you're a Christ follower. You were created to care, and you have the ministry of reconciliation. And what are you doing if you cut people out of your lives in this way and say of them, I just don't care anymore? What do you do? What message are you sending to those who know you? In 2 Corinthians 5:14 says this, Christ's love compels us. Christ's love constrains us. Christ's love for us, Christ's love for me, means I don't have the choice to do whatever I want. Sometimes I have to do what Christ wants. I have to say yes to him and no to me. It's not because of what they have done. It's not because of what they will do, but in spite of it. So set the table, open the door, just in case there comes the day when they want to come in. Let's pray. Father, these are much easier things to talk about than to do. Because these relationships are tricky. These relationships are messy. These relationships are complicated. And some of us have been through many rounds with people in our lives. We've tried many times. We've been treated badly many times. But Lord, we pray that you will help us. You will help us to not lie to ourselves or to you and say, I just don't care anymore. Because you've created us to care and you've given us the ministry of reconciliation. Lord Jesus, you gave yourself for us. And now we are challenged to do the same for those who have acted towards us in a small way, the way we acted towards you. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Fill us with your Spirit. Because this does not come naturally to us. This is hard for us. This is something that we can't do ourselves. We can only do it through you. So we pray for your help in Jesus' name. Amen.